going down to the shindig. 409, 100 years old, to the shindig.
That Nina Saxon is here. She is the liaison for Harlem for the comptroller's office, Scott Stringer's office, and she has been in this position for over 7 years. And as we all know, Scott Stringer is very devoted to the Harlem community, and so thankfully for Nina, she keeps him on his toes, and he wanted to be here this evening and had a previous engagement. So Nina has a presentation from his office. Nina, thank you.
Good evening, Harlem. So I wanna also thank, we have our amazing Manhattan Borough President, Gail Brewer, who is in the house today. That you are celebrating a centennial year.
Yes.
So he wanted to make sure that you go out in style. So I'm gonna read this to you. 409 Edgecombe Avenue Apartment, 100th anniversary. For a century of outstanding work to build an active and vibrant community in Harlem, for its commitment to preserving and promoting Harlem's rich culture and unique history, for honoring the remarkable accomplishments and contributions of 409 Edgecombe Avenue residents, including the Honorable Thurgood Marshall, W.E.B. Du Bois, Aaron Douglas, and William Stanley Bathwaite. For keeping the spirit of the Harlem Renaissance alive in the 21st century, for building a foundation on which families can grow and strive, and for its tremendous contributions to the city of New York, I dub the New York City Comptroller Scott Stringer 409 Day. It is a new day. Congratulations!
I want to say that this is very quickly in 2020 going to be Harlem Renaissance. And we just had at Shepherd Hall, some of you might have been there, a Harlem Renaissance kickoff with all of the cultural and preservation institutions in Harlem, plus Jazzmobile, all day jazz. That is like being here, 409. And really, you are the representative of what Harlem Renaissance, you're 100 even sooner, but the fact of the matter is this wonderful building is representative of the great of New York. And what I love is coming out here in the summer and wandering up and down, you see Wendy, everybody else, wandering up and down, cooking, and making sure that the community is recognized. And that's what 409 has always done, and I want to congratulate you. Obviously, there are many well-known people here. I see Community Board 10 and 9 represented here. That's another example. Tad Moore, thank you. So I'm here also to congratulate you and to say that it's a wonderful opportunity to recognize you in terms of proclamations, but to say that these departments have stood the heyday and challenging times. Landmark from the Landmark Preservation Commission in 1991. That's also challenging and good. I'm a huge preservationist, but I know about the challenges also. You are a 13-story building. You have intricate three-part facade on a hilltop. You really are distinguished inside and outside. That's really important. 30s and 50s, you were Sugar Hill's most prestigious address. In my book, you still are. And Nina kindly mentioned all the amazing people who have lived here. People of national and international renown lived here at 409 Edgecombe as a home, as a place to entertain, always music, always culture, which is what Harlem has always been part of. Safe haven, come to overcome all obstacles. So I, Gail Brewer, as your borough president, hereby commend 409, you gotta come back with the proclamation. Come on back, come on.
You gotta work.
So I, Gail Brewer, as your borough president, do hereby commend 409 Edgecombe on its centennial anniversary and proclaim Saturday, October 20th, 2018, 409 Edgecombe Avenue Appreciation Day in the borough of Manhattan!
Kelamon is the heir apparent for the seat. With Farrell vacating the seat midterm, New York State law allowed for the Democratic District Committee for the Assembly District to select the candidate for the general election, bypassing a primary for the seat. Taylor, being the district leader, who ultimately leads the district committee, easily was chosen as the candidate. With the seat overwhelmingly Democratic, Taylor won the seat unopposed and was sworn in soon after. His office is Stanley Gleaton, who would like to share some words with us today.
Thank you so very much. Hello, 409. I'm here representing, as you just heard, Assemblyman Al Taylor. He would have liked to have been here, and knowing Al, he may walk in here any minute. So, but it was on my schedule, so I just want you to make sure that you let him know that I was here. But on behalf of his office, 100 years, that's really an amazing feat. The people who lived in here, who passed on, and the people who are presently living here now, we really want to congratulate you and honor the presence. And honor your presence here. I used to have a friend in this building, and so I know this building for many years, and I stopped coming because they moved, but I definitely will be back. This is a wonderful spread. You know, maybe next year you'll have another one just like this. Because I don't think I can wait another 100 years. So, but definitely, I'm having a great time. I want to congratulate 409. I know the Assemblyman would like to do the same. In his absence, I'm here. Like I said, if he comes, definitely he will be able to speak to you. But on behalf of Assemblyman Al Taylor, we want to congratulate 409 on 100 years, and thank you.
We have the Manhattan Community Board 10 member, George Harrell.
Harrell.
Our friend and neighbor, sister, Secretary of the Edgecombe Avenue Block Association, Yvonne. Our crime prevention officer, police officer Miranda Toshiba. Miranda. And with her, joining her, is Captain Marchese.
Can I just...
Yes.
I'm sorry, I forgot to, one quick thing. We do have a proclamation slash citation 4409. It was left in the office inadvertently, so we will definitely be delivering it next week. So this, well, we don't want to be left out. With Nina and the borough president, I felt like chopped liver, but now I know. But thank you all so very much.
And so we have a special treat this evening. Her boy is here. Her boy is an American journalist, educator, author, and activist. His articles appear regularly in the New York Amsterdam News. He teaches Black Studies at the City College of New York and the College of New Rochelle. Mr. Boyd was born in Birmingham, Alabama, and grew up in Detroit, Michigan. He met Malcolm X in 1958 and credits him as an inspiration. He says, "Malcolm set me on the path to become the writer activist I am, to try to live up to the very emboldening, ennobling themes that he represented." With those words, I would like to have everyone give Mr. Boyd a round of applause.
Don't stop. Whoa, I'm taking you on the road with me, you know.
Hey,
oh, Gail, how do you say happy birthday to a building? Huh? There you go. What are Al Taylor, and there's another Taylor that should be recognized, and that's Karen Taylor. Don't forget Karen, you know, because while we're still here is the organization, her brain trust, and she brought me aboard to be the kind of historian, you know, for the whole community of Harlem, but particularly on two buildings, 555 Edgecombe and here, 409 Edgecombe. I mean, most of you know the history of this building. It goes all the way back to 1916, 1917. Simon Schwartz and Arthur Gross, you know, the architects. Matter of fact, you can look around this whole community, particularly along Riverside Drive and Central Park West, and see the nearly 200 buildings that Mr. Schwartz and Mr. Gross pulled together. They were just absolutely prolific and busy in putting the buildings together. Before they put 409 together, they did 55 Edgecombe, just a year before. So this is just an example, exemplary of the kind of magnificent architectural genius that they had. But more than that, it's more than just who designed this edifice, but who lived in it. And you know, I'm looking around at some of the photographs, some of the pictures representing the Thurgood Marshalls, and looking at Mr. Wilkins back there, my goodness, you talk about the distinguished, the Black elite. They call it the Black White House, you know, at one point. They had so many distinguished individuals here, as it was in 55 Edgecombe. They had a number of celebrities there too, particularly the entertainers and musicians. Julius Bledsoe, you can hear his magnificent voice. Remember, he did in terms of Old Man River. Even before Paul Robeson, you know, made him famous. You had Julius Bledsoe. You had people like Madame Stephanie St. Clair. You ever heard of Stephanie St. Clair? You know, and Safi Hamed, her husband, you know, Bumpy Johnson hung out in here. We had the distinguished and the indistinguished, didn't we? All of them were here. One of the three people I'd like to have you reflect on, one being Catherine Butler Jones.
Yes.
When I was doing a book called Harlem Reader, she was putting together a manuscript, a memoir, in effect, because she was living in this building. Matter of fact, she was born in a building back in 1909. I won't give away her age of it. But all the way back to when Black people were not even living in here in a regular way. She came in with her family, and she talked about Harold Thomas, who used to be the doorman here. She talked about Thelma Wilson, who had so many remarkable memories, and told her all about Stephanie St. Clair, what was going on with her and Bumpy Johnson and Sufi Hamid, to say nothing of Dutch Schultz, you know, in terms of the whole struggle over policy, the numbers here in Harlem. So Catherine Butler, she's in Newton, Massachusetts, where she lives now. And she's been working on her book for a number of years. I hope she can get it done. She's already put together a play that was performed up in Massachusetts. Just a remarkable writer, thorough historian, and her memories about this building are just absolutely immaculate, right down to talking about the doorman and who lived on her floor, below and above, looking out and looking at Polo Grounds and Yankee Stadium, you know, all of those views that she had from the apartment window. But beyond Catherine Butler Jones, there is Marvell Cook.
Yes.
You ever hear Marvell Cook?
Oh, yes.
I was brought to this building in 1999 to interview Marvell Cook by a very fine, distinguished poet who's no longer with us. You may remember hers. This Sophia Henderson Holmes. What an outstanding poet she was. And she brought me over so I could talk to Marvell Cook. Now Marvell Cook, if you don't know who she was like all over the place in terms of a member of the Communist Party at a time when, you know, that was not at all something that what people looked forward to. But she was an activist par excellence. She worked with Ella Baker. Ella Baker, another civil rights icon, they did a thing called a Bronx slave market, looking at domestic workers back in the 1930s. And that's just a remarkable piece of research that Marvell did. But she was connected with W.E.B. Du Bois. And of course, Du Bois, this building is, you know, you can't go more than one or two sentences without talking about Du Bois and his residency here. And of course, Catherine Butler Jones has a lot of information and memories about Du Bois here. But Marvell Cook was working as his secretary at Crisis Magazine and putting together all of those remarkable articles that came out of the NAACP's house organ at that time. And then, of course, Sophia Henderson Holmes. We lost her much too early, but she was instrumental in bringing me into this here family, and I feel so connected because, you know, just looking over some of her poetry, pick up the Daily Bread, a collection of her poetry, get an idea of how perspicacious she was, how clairvoyant, kind of prophetic voice that she had. So Gail, I don't know, did Gail split on this already? Karen, I don't know where Karen is at this moment, but if anyone's to be celebrated, as far as I'm concerned, you can talk about Marvell Cook and Catherine Butler Jones and Sophia Henderson Holmes, but my heart goes out to Karen Taylor. Karen, where are you? All right, 409, happy birthday, building.
I want to talk about Gia Williams. Yeah. To thank her because Gia is the sunlight of this building, and since March has been out of her home and displaced because of a horrible fire in her apartment. And living all the way in Queens and actually missing for almost 2 weeks because she was in a diabetic coma in the hospital and couldn't communicate who her family was. And seeing her after the fire and in the hospital, and to see her tonight on this stage. Gia, you make us proud.
Yes,
you make
you
us
do.
So proud. Oh, look who walked in.
Michael
Henry Adams.
Yay!
He is a historian, and let me plug him next week to kind of round out and up our celebration for the month. Mr. Adams will be lecturing on the history of 409 Edgecombe at 3 p.m., preceding our Helmsley-Jackson chess tournament. So we would love to see everyone next week to celebrate as well. Without further ado, because I'm talking too much, Gia Williams!
This song, I can remember when I was in the kindergarten and in the first grade. This song was played on all black holidays, Old Man River. And I remember when we would look at TV, when I finally got there, Paul Robeson used to always sing this song and talk about what it meant to him to keep persevering. When times got hard, never give up. And I just feel it would be very appropriate to sing this song for you, because there are not many buildings now that have the reputation that 409 has or 555. Our people have been so instrumental in making America better than it was. And I see since I've been born, since March, there's so many newborn babies here. And I'm touched. I am so touched. We must never give up. And we must always keep pursuing. Find out for yourselves and teach your children. Stop letting your children beat up on others. People on canes and walkers, almost 100 years old, and you're going to hurt them and beat them? That's wrong. It's our responsibility to teach our children in the homes. That's how we were taught. We still must not give up on ourselves because we are a beautiful people. That's why I'm so glad to see so many different ethnic groups here. I'm glad. And the way everybody greeted me when I came in here today. I was here 2 weeks ago and you would have thought that I was a celebrity.
Yes, ma'am.
I felt the love coming from north, south, east, and west. I thank you. And I've lived here, I think, about 20 years. And 2 months after I moved in, building that core. Thank you for feeling that way about me, because that's the way I feel about you. Every morning that I wake up, I always say, happy birthday, because I'm thankful to be alive. I'm thankful that's a birthday present. Everything was gone in my apartment, but I'm alive. And I was in my 20s, I would have had to go to Bellevue. But everything that was destroyed, I can get again. My life. Someone said that the Daily News had a copy of me coming out of my apartment saying, I'm alive. I have to get that picture. I'm thankful. And when I come in here and see the happiness and the warmth, I'm so happy. So give yourselves a big round.
To get to sugar in my
dances when she was 6 years old.
Wow.
7 years old, I'm sorry. Okay, 7 years old, I was a year off. If you want to know what happened, if you want to know how it looked, if you want to know what they said, if you want to know what they did, ask Laverne Jacobs, and she will know. She's as sharp as a tack. One of the wonderful stories she shared with me was that not only was Erin Douglas her art teacher, the famous Erin Douglas was her art teacher, but she used to take music lessons, and I believe it was your cello, and she would stand right here on the corner with her cello and was trying to get it up the hill. Every week, Thurgood Marshall, harried and rushing, I'm sure, to get to his post at the NAACP, would stop and help little Laverne take her cello up the hill every week. I had the pleasure of sharing that story with his son, Thurgood Marshall Jr., and he said it touched him dearly because he doesn't have a whole lot of memories of his father as a humanist, you know, as a man. And so to hear that story really touched his soul. So thank you for sharing everything you share with us. You're such a treasure to us. Now, Ms. Gaither wants to read something, but she's not going to come up the stage. She's going to sit at her seat. So may I have everyone's attention while Ms. Gaither speaks?
I'm glad they made the correction. I'm not the oldest in the building. I just have lived here the longest. For 81 years, when I was 7 years old, we moved in here. And I won't give you, like, no, you lot, you saw the film and you probably know a lot of the history already. But I do have a little something that I paraphrased to leave with you. And it's called Remember. Today is your day, it's our day. Live life fully. Be courageous. And continue to follow your dreams regardless of age. Take time to appreciate the moments, for they will soon be memories. Dance, sing, play, no matter what your age. Believe in the power and your strength. Inspire someone. Be brave, take a chance, be spontaneous. Don't abuse your health and surround yourself with people who will put a smile on your face. Seek peace.
Ashe.
And learn something new every day. Create happiness and laugh a lot. Enjoy the little things, be gracious and kind. Smile at a stranger. We're on this journey together. And we must make it work. For life is beautiful and it is what you make it. Best wishes to all of you. I am so happy to be alive to witness this 100th birthday. The 100th birthday of our building, that is really something. And I have a lot of wonderful memories still. And I'm able to know where I live and what my name is.
Amen. Amen.
I got very emotional. These are hallowed halls.
Yes. Yes.
And we have the privilege every day to walk the footsteps of W.E.B. Du Bois and his wife, who's in the corner by the car.
Wow.
And Reverend Moran Weston, who is in the back corner by Corinne, honoring Thurgood Marshall.
Woo!
At St. Philip's. And we have May Edward Chen,
yes,
who was the first black graduate of black female graduate of Bellevue, and the first at Harlem Hospital to do a residency, and she could not practice medicine at Harlem Hospital.
Wow, that's great.
So there was an Edgecombe Sanitarium, and that's where she worked first, and she actually rented this apartment here and ran a practice at one point and lived in the building as well. I think on the other side, I mean, you'll see Erin Douglas and his wife If you have an opportunity to go to the Schomburg in 1987, 89 trunks were taken from this basement under lock and key and sent to the Schomburg. Where with it was described by Mary Yearwood from the Schomburg that they had a crowbar. And what we know of the Schomburg Institute on 135th wasn't what we know now. So without electricity, in the winter, with gloves and a hat, they were opening up these trunks trying to figure out what could possibly be inside. And one, she mentioned that one of the true treasures were love letters from Aaron Douglas to his beloved. And there's a picture over here of that. There's a picture in the front. Roy Wilkins, Walter White, and Thurgood Marshall lived in this building at the same time. This picture in the front, as you leave, please notice that they are together in front of the headquarters of the NAACP here in New York. Eunice Hunton Carter here. She was the first African-American female prosecutor for the Manhattan District Attorney's Office. She walked out of that elevator
and
through those doors every day, just like me. Just like you. And just like this case every day. And so, William's family Rackley, his family is in this building. Still a great poet.
Yes.
And so what I want to say to our family, the immediate family, to our friends, is that these are hallowed halls and we are so proud of them.
Yes.
And this is an ongoing Harlem Renaissance.
This is forever
a renewal of Black culture, of African American history, music, politics, activism. You name it, it happens here. Be proud. Thank you so much for being here tonight. Thank you.
Thank you.
so happy to be here on this momentous occasion. Not all of us will make 100 years of life, but those of us who live in Harlem and in New York know that our lives are enriched by having buildings that have witnessed the history of centuries, that have witnessed the actions of our ancestors. And you may think that a building like 409 Edgecombe, the Colonial Parkway Apartments, you may think that it's important because of how distinctive it is and how unique all the people who lived here were. But in point of fact, what makes them important, the Miller Huggins and the Thurgood Marshalls and the Aaron Douglases and the Marvell Cooks, is that they reflect all of us and the potential that exists in each and every one of us to greatness. They are a microcosm of how in America, how in the world, everything is connected to everything else. And if Harlem is the hub of the universe, then 409 is at its center, and extending out from that center like the spokes of a wheel, we are all connected to everything that happens.
Yes.
And this glorious building, which will continue, and one hopes that it will continue not as it started out, as a place where only one type of people were able to live,
yes,
and not as it evolved, where a place abandoned by a whole group of people and where blacks lived by default, but as the kind of diverse and rich place that it is today. So I say to you all, congratulations on this first century of great accomplishment and achievement, and wish for 409 and for Harlem that same kind of history in the future. Thank you so much.
Thank you. And we're going to take you back to a time when Harlem was very interesting. Harlem's always been interesting, but for me, the 70s was one of those times when we had cross culture. We had the best and the worst of times. We had Isaac Hayes, who wrote a score for the movie Shaft. And we're gonna do one of those. It's called Do Your Thing. And today, we want everybody to celebrate and do your own thing.
All right.
It's not about politics. It doesn't matter if you're from the left, from the right, if you're a conservative or liberal. There's certain things that apply to all of us. Clean air, clean water.
That's right.
Okay, there's a group of people trying to make their way north from Central America, about 3,000, to the land of opportunity. I don't know if that's a good thing or a bad thing, but it's what's happening. And remember, most of our produce comes from California, but in the past few years, they've had fire, flood. If we weren't importing, we would be facing food shortages.
Yes.
So, do your thing. And if you know this song, we encourage you to clap your hands. Stomp your feet. You can dance, it's not illegal yet. Do your thing.
Thank you.